Bring it back. 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 From the And the Groove Remains Production Team Studios in the Netherlands. My name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, my mission is to educate and teach you about collection management and conversion for DJs so you save yourself more time for the fun and creative part of being a DJ. For those of you who are unfamiliar with who I am, let me get my slides up because that always tells the story much easier. Here we go. I am the guy behind the DJ Conversion Utility. I am a 55-year-old dude from the Netherlands. I had my first DJ residency at the age of 15, which means this is almost 40 years of DJ experience in the flesh. And these days I like to share that experience with you guys each Tuesday evening, 7 o'clock p.m. Central European time, I host this Ask Me Anything live stream, where I answer each and every question you may have about DJ tech in general, collection management, conversion, macOS tech, the works. The difference between other AMA live streams is that I not only answer your questions, but I also try to demonstrate stuff, showing you how it all works. Today is May the 3rd, which means tomorrow is May 4th. And May 4th, as all you geeks know, is Star Wars Day. May the Force be with you. May the 4th. And for that reason, I took this special shirt, of course, a Stormtrooper playing Star Wars. And that was also by special request of Darth Vader, who you can see right there at the end of the studio in the flesh. That's a life-size Darth Vader replica. So yes, I am a Star Wars fan, and yes, I like to do this kind of stuff. So that is the reason why I am dressed like the way I am today, in a Star Wars shirt. What are we going to do today? I am going to talk DJ Tech, of course, with you guys. I have some prepared subjects that I want to go over with you. I want to go over the new Engine DJ, because it has some features that I really, really like, and there are some options that I made available with updates. I will talk about an update I did to the DJ conversion utility last week, or actually the week before, and some other things. So I have some things that I need to go about, but I'm also here to answer each and every question you may have. So if you have a question, just drop it in the chat. If I'm in the middle of a story, then I will not go into it right away, because otherwise it gets so messy. But I promise you, I always get back to it and see what we can do about it. One more thing that is very important. Next week, for all you guys out there, I have my special friend DJ TLM, The Last Mohemian, over here, right here, live in the studio. So that means we are not going to be on an online connection. No, he will be here with me. He might play a little bit with my stuff. And of course, he will also be here to answer each and every question of you, especially on the scratch part. He is a maestro. So if you got questions for DJ TLM, he's with me next week, 7 o'clock p.m. Central European time. And of course, I hope to see you guys then as well. But in the meantime, while we are at it, let's say hi to the people in the chat. AG Flow DJ, happy Tuesday to you and good to see you. Hassan, good to see you too. And indeed, maybe I need a Tupac poster to go with the Biggie poster. On the other hand, I think Biggie is one of the biggest wordsmiths out there. I really like his lyrics. So that's the reason why, for those of you who missed it, there is a Biggie painting actually right on the wall above the jukebox, which is there to in honor to Biggie. But Tupac is great as well. But it is just a matter of taste, of course. Wanen, good to see you too. Happy Tuesday. And nice to have you in the chat. And as usual, guys, if I mess up my cams, just say it to me in the chat, because sometimes I am so caught up in my story that I'm not realizing that I didn't switch the cam. So I think that you can see what I'm seeing on my screen, but actually I didn't switch it, so you can't see it. And well, that makes a whole mess. I had the pleasure to be a guest on my friend Cleveland Terry's AMA last Thursday. And of course, I forgot to switch cams in the middle of my story. So just for all you guys out there, if I forget to switch cams, just throw it in the chat and I'll be happy to switch it back. What else can we talk about? What else do I need to talk about before we get started? I think I covered it all pretty well for now, which means let's go on with the show. First of all, the DJ conversion utility. I did add an extra feature to the DJ conversion utility, which I personally like very much. In my real life collection, I use iTunes as the collection manager to create playlists and all kinds of stuff and to make sure that all the tags are complete. Reason for that is simple. iTunes is available in any other music software on macOS, which means if you make a playlist in iTunes, you can see it in all the DJ software, so you need to only make it once. That's the reason why that is my integral collection manager. And one of the sorting criteria I use most often is date added. When a track was added, the date that the track was added to the collection. Now, that's all fine for me because, hey, I'm using this workflow for like 10 years, so that's all good. However, if you want to adopt that workflow and you come from, let's say, Rekordbox, and you use the DJ conversion utility to convert playlists from Rekordbox to iTunes, then all of a sudden those date edits are all going to be the same. The date edit will always be the same date, namely the date that you run the DJ conversion utility. And the thing is, we cannot change that. iTunes doesn't allow changing the date edit field because, hey, it is what it is. It says, if you add the track, I will fixate the date edit, and there's no way you can change that. In order to work around that, and that was coming from the last stream we did, I added the date edit to a different tag. So I make it possible to add the date edit from Rekordbox to a different tag, naming the grouping tag. And let me show you guys how that works, because it isn't that different or difficult, and it isn't rocket science at all. But let me fire up the Rekordbox collection and let's see if I got something. Yeah, Hassan, hold on, that's a different question to give. I will get into that later, Hassan. Let me finish this one first. Let's see if I can find an old Rekordbox collection that I can use, because we want to have a Rekordbox collection actually with some date edits different than today. So maybe this one will have it. We'll never know. This is just an account that I always use to do all kinds of different stuff. So let's see what we are going to do. Here we are. And indeed, there are some tracks here, as we can see. And yay, we got the date created. No, I want the date edit. You see that the date edit is here different. It's all 2021. Now, let me put those tracks inside playlist. Let's name it test one, like this. And let's see if those tracks are available. I don't know. Yeah, they are available. That's important. And let's export that collection in XML format, so we are ready to use that in the DJ conversion utility. I can quit the Rekordbox right here and can fire up the DJ conversion utility. Mind you, this is a slightly different version than the latest version that is out there. I did tweak some things, but I didn't find it important enough to make it a release yet. So there is some stuff coming up, but it's not huge. It is mainly log file related, because I wanted to change some stuff in the log. So if you say, hey, Mixmaster, where can I get version 5.052? It's not out. It's only on my system right now. But hey, it will be out later on. We are going to iTunes, and right here you see date edit to grouping. And as you can see, it is off by default. I did that on a purpose, because if you use the grouping field for anything else, you don't want it to mess with the date edit. So that's the reason why it's off by default. But I will enable it. Hold on. I thought I had a sneeze coming up, but hey, it didn't go through. Let's do this and let's wait for it to finish its stuff. And in the meantime, let's see what Hassan has to say. So to give the audience our previous issue we were tackling for a bit of background, it was regarding Rekordbox export issues where some tracks would transfer over but without any waveform analysis. Seems that this may be a Rekordbox 6 and beyond issue. Ah, that's good to know, Hassan. Personally, I haven't discovered this. I never had an issue with exporting to USB. Always all my waveforms are there, but I remember that you talked about it. What Hassan is meaning is that he exported some tracks from Rekordbox, and those tracks were analyzed in Rekordbox and look fine in Rekordbox. They have a waveform in Rekordbox. However, the moment he was playing those tracks on a CDJ, the CDJ didn't display the waveforms, and he was wondering why. And it turns out that his answer is, or actually I think he got that answer from Pioneer DJ, is that it is related to the latest versions of Rekordbox. Like I said, I haven't really experienced that, but hey, I can imagine that it might be. Hey, where is the grouping left? Oh, it can only find two tracks. All right, fair enough. I didn't check if all the tracks were available as I told you, but right here you can see that the grouping now has the proper date edit, while the date edit has the date of today. So that is what this little feature does, what this little thingy does within the DJ Converse utility. It will now convert those tracks as well. And if you think, hey Mixmaster G, why isn't this complete? Most likely because some of the tracks couldn't be found in that record box collection. I used a very old record box collection, so I don't know what was in that. So that is about the DJ Converse utility and date edit to grouping. I made it so that the grouping field is sortable, which means the year will be in front of it, then the month, and then the actual day. And if necessary, there will be a zero in front of the number. If it's a one-digit number, it will always be a two-digit number. So it is sortable, so you can very quickly add on the date added first or the date added last by just sorting on that grouping window. And I think that is something that a lot of you can find convenient. All right, so that's that. Then the next thing I want to talk with you guys about is an addition that Dan and DJ made to Engine DJ. Engine DJ, as you might know, is the software that runs on Engine Gear and is the software that is used to prepare a USB for use on Engine Gear. And what Dan and DJ finally added, and thank you Dan and DJ for that, are active saved loops. What are active saved loops? Active saved loops are loops that will automatically become active the moment the playback head enters the playback or the loop itself. It is a feature that has been long standing available within Rekordbox. You can mimic it in Traktor, but you could not do it in Engine. The only way on Prime Gear to activate the loop was actually to be inside the loop and then press the corresponding saved loop pad, or you needed to press it in advance and then it would immediately jump to that loop. That were the only options. First, let me tell you a little bit about saved loops in Rekordbox, because there is some confusion about it. And let's take the confusion away. So let me fire up Rekordbox again and show you what it is all about. So if we have, is that track available? That track is available. Which track is not available? Oh, that track is not available. All right. This track is available. If, for instance, we place a cue point right here. Let me turn the volume down so you don't hear all the noise. And then let's say that these are beats. Right now they are not, but hey, let's say they are empty beats. You want to make that a loop that will automatically activate. You can do that in the hot bank. However, the preferred way to do that is by doing it to the memory bank. You can see the little orange looping symbol behind it. That means it's a loop. If I click that orange symbol, it will become red. A red loop means that it will automatically activate. Now, if I deactivate the loop and go a little bit in front of it, like for instance here, let me place the cue right there. Now, if I play the track from here, you can see that the loop automatically arms the moment the playback head enters and it keeps on spinning. So that's fine. I'm now in expert mode. If I am in performance mode, let me go to performance mode. There we are, performance mode. Then it's even possible to make a loop, an active loop, as a hot loop. However, this is not officially supported. I will show you that it's possible, so I can do it right here. You see the orange thing. If I click it, it becomes red. So now it is an active loop. And if I go in front of it, just a little bit in front of it, and I play the track from there, like this, then you will see that that hot bank stored active loop will actually work. You see that's this one, that's the hot bank active loop, and it is now working automatically. However, if I export this to a CDJ USB, it will not work on a CDJ. It will not work on a 3000. It will not work on a Nexus 2002. It just doesn't work, not with the latest firmware. It only works with Rekordbox on controllers, and that is why I recommend you not to use hot cues saved loops because it is not reliable enough. You cannot rely on it. That memory loop that I stored will always work. So if I start it right here, there you go. It activates automatically and it will start. That will always work on the latest CDJ. So this is the safe thing to do. Another thing with Rekordbox that you need to know is that it can only have one active memory loop. So if I go back to my export mode, because that shows it the clearest, let me do that here, right here. There we are again. I go to the hot bank and I go to my loop right there. You can see that all of a sudden it is orange again. While if I'm in performance mode, it's still red. So that already gives you, you see that? It's the same loop. Let me rename it so you see this is a hot loop. You see right here it's red, but if I go to the export mode, you can see that all of a sudden it becomes, oh, it hold on, there we are. It is orange. So it's the same loop, but you already see the difference, and that's why I don't find it very reliable. Furthermore, like I said, you can only have one. We already have a saved loop in the memory bank right there. If I add another one and I try to make that active, you can see I can do it, but the other one will go off. So you can only have, there can only be one. It is a little bit like that movie, right? There can only be one. So that is something that you need to keep in mind too. And the last thing that is important to keep in mind is that the XML that we all use as a base for conversion, if you convert for, let's say Traktor or to Serato or to Algorithm DJ or to Engine DJ, you need to have a Rekordbox XML as a base of your conversion. That Rekordbox XML does not contain any information if a saved loop is active or not. So that means you lose that information if you export it. Let me just show that first. Let me just show how that all works. So I export the collection to XML. If we name it Rekordbox, then my tools will automatically find it. And if I start up the Denon conversion utility, hold on, those tracks, where are those stored? That is important because I think they're on a terabyte. All right, then I need to go to an external drive. And that will only add to the confusion. Let me make quickly a Rekordbox collection that at least I know what I'm doing, because right now I don't know where those tracks are stored, and if they are on the file server, then Engine DJ doesn't work with it, etc., 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 which only complicates stuff. So let me just empty the collection like this and add one of the test tracks, just a random one like this. Load it up. Need to analyze it. Like that. Let's give it, I like to do that near the end, so let's give it right here a loop, store it in memory, make it red. So that's an active loop. And let's put a queue in front of it so we can easily find it. So if we play right here, then you can see that after a while, it will enter the loop and it will activate automatically and starts looping. For some reason, it doesn't do that because I hold the cue, but if I do the play button, then it should. That is, by the way, something else. So there we go again. Now, let me show you what this means. Let's double check that it's not in the playlist. So let's add it to the playlist. Export collection to Rekordbox XML like this. Fire up the Denon conversion utility. Like I told you already, the XML doesn't contain the saved or the active status of the saved loop. So it will not convert it to an active saved loop. In a moment, I will show you what I did to make it possible right now. I'm just going to show you how it normally works. Like this. There we go. And guys, I see your questions. I will get to that in a moment. Let me first round this off. And then I'm happy to answer the questions that are coming through in the chat. So hold on. I see them. I will get to them in a moment. Let's analyze the track like this. Quit engine DJ because the dynamic conversion utility is not completed yet. No, I don't need to see it. And here we have the test one playlist. And if we load the track, then you can see that here is the beat marker. There is the cue. And if you go to the loop section, you can see that the loop is right there. It is wide and it's wide with a purpose because it's coming from a memory loop and a memory loop cannot have a color by default. Now the next thing I want to do is the following. I need to make sure that one of my apps is switched off because otherwise it will only add to the confusion. Just let me switch this off for the moment. I did switch it off already. All right, that's switched off. Now let's go back to Rekordbox because the information about if a loop is active or not is not saved in the XML. I had to come up with a different solution, and that solution is the Denon Converse utility will look at the name of the loop. If I name that loop active loop, or if I name it active space loop, or if I name it hashtag CL, which is an abbreviation for catch loop, or if I name it catch loop, then the Denon conversion utility will make that loop an active loop. And let me show you how that works. So right here we have the active loop. And let's tell it that we want to make it. There we are. Hashtag CL. Now, the Denon conversion utility, or actually Engine Prime, can do something that Rekordbox cannot. I can set a second active loop here. I can also name that hashtag CL, and then I will set a third loop right here, and I will let that maintain as a normal loop. Memory, there we are, normal loop. So basically I've got three loops. I've got one loop named normal loop and two that are named hashtag CL, which is an abbreviation for catch loop. Now, let me export that information to my Rekordbox XML again. Remember, if you change something in your source DJ software, you need to create a new Rekordbox XML. That means I have to export the collection to Rekordbox again, like this. And let me fire up the Denon conversion utility again, which will go a lot faster this time around because the track has already been analyzed and you will tell immediately the difference. So let's start it up like this. And then we tell it that we want to convert the test one playlist. And let it go over it. And if I load the track up right now and we go to the loop section, then we see that nothing has been converted. That's weird. Oh, I had the protection on. My bad, my friends. My bad, I fall in my own knife this time around. There is a setting in the Denon Converse utility that makes sure that you don't accidentally override cues and loops. And that is by default on as a protection. So nothing will change. So that is this one. And if I take it off, which I needed to do earlier, then we will be fine for that. So my bad. You can see, I make mistakes with my own stuff. So that happens sometimes, but you cannot be too cautious. So I really appreciate that setting to be there. And if you go to an external drive, I'm all on the internal drive now. But if you go to an external drive, then it will automatically recognize it. You see, that looks a lot better. So we've got here the normal loop. Then you see the little A behind CL and a little A behind CL there. That means those are active loops. You can see they are dashed. So if I go in front of that loop, hold on, let me disable it. Loop-de-loop, there we are. Let's turn off. Let's go a little bit in front of it. And if the track starts playing and it enters the loop, it will automatically activate exactly the same as it works on Rekordbox. However, we don't have one. But this time around we have two. The other one, the catch loop, will also work. at the end of the track, the moment it enters it, it will activate and it will start to spin. Now, this is all nice, of course, because you can do it. Now, you saw me disable the cue and loop parameter tool. The cue and loop parameter tool comes with all my conversion tools. It's free. It's in the miscellaneous folder of the DMG. And it allows you to assign colors to a specific cue or loop based on its name. And you can see right here, the hashtag CL is there and it makes the cue red. And it's named catch loop. So if I store the settings and if I run just the Denon Converge utility once again, you will see that those changes are immediately in effect. So it will make it a red cue, which makes it easy, or a red loop, which makes it easier for us to recognize, especially if you're on the player. So that is why I like to do it like that. Don't forget to take the protection off, which I just did. And then we just go very quickly through this. And run the conversion. And that was it. Now if I load up the track again and I go to loop, you can see that the catch loops are all of a sudden named catch loop. So it makes the abbreviation white, it makes it the normal text. And you can see that those are red like we said they needed to be. So those are little tricks you can do with the Denon Converge utility now. Mind you that this also works if you are, for instance, on Serato or Traktor. So let me show that from Serato as well, that it will still be an active loop. Let me fire up Serato, but it works the same in Traktor, it works the same in anything else. Let's take a different track just for testing sake. And let's create a crate there. And let's name that from Serato, and let's add a track to that from Serato crate like this, and let's load it up and let's give it a catch loop. Let's see, why do I set it? Let's set it there, why not, on the 70. Where is my loop setting? There is my loop setting, and let's add it there. And if I name it again hashtag CL or catch loop, or let me do it a little bit, active loop. That doesn't have an entry, by the way, in the CLP. So let me give another loop just a CL abbreviation so you can tell the difference, that there, and that is hashtag CL like this. And let's quit Serato right here. And then fire up the DJ conversion utility, because I need to create that RecordBox XML as a base. So for this particular conversion, I need both the DJ conversion utility and the Denon conversion utility. And let's make sure that my backup drive is, oh, it's not available. All right. We go from Serato. I don't need to go to RecordBox 6, so I don't invoke X26, just for the speed of things, just to keep the speed up. And then we can say we are going from Serato like this. Because that's the crate I just created. And I can fire up the Denon Converge utility right away. I already created the RecordBox XML, the RecordBox DGCU XML was created by the DJ Conversion Utility going from Serato to RecordBox. And now the Denon Conversion Utility will pick up that RecordBox DGCU XML, as you can see right here. The track is not in the collection, so I don't need the protection, but let's take it off just for safeguards. It needs to be analyzed. So it will pop up in a moment for that, or it will prompt in a moment for that.
The Denon Conversion utility needs your attention.
There we are. And mind you, that analysis is always required once for each track. And once it has been analyzed, you will be good to go. Hold on. Analyze track. That's it. Quit it. And wait for the Denon Conversion utility to finish. It will automatically start Engine DJ again. And then we will have two active loops from Serato converted to engine DJ based on the loop's name. So that is the takeaway from this. The loop's name dictates if a loop will be an active saved loop or just a normal saved loop, which can make all the difference, of course. Let me load up the track like this. Let's go to the loop. There you've got the catch loop, and you can see it is red because that was taken from the conversion or from the queue and loop parameter to the entry from the queue loop there. This is an active loop. It is still active because both the term catch loop and active loop will create a saved active loop. And the moment I play my track, that loop will activate automatically and it will start looping. This, by the way, folks, is really a great technique in case you forget or you miss your mix out window. I use it on Traktor all the time. Traktor doesn't have active saved loops, but you can activate a loop in advance in Traktor. And Traktor is my based DJ software. And I'm so happy that this is finally in Engine DJ, because this can be such a powerful tool. So I really, really, really would recommend you guys to make at the end of a track, at the empty beat part, a loop, name it hashtag CL. And after that, my conversion tools will take care of that. So do that. It can save you much time and much frustration. Let's see. I had some questions, so we are going to about that there. Randy Lawrence is asking me, can you create a playlist in Engine like Serato? And can you make them directly in Engine? Yeah, you can make them directly in Engine. Here we are in Engine. And you saw me converting from Serato. So if I look in the converted playlist, you see there is the playlist from Serato, which was literally coming from Serato. That is created by my conversion tools. But if you are not that person to use conversion tools, then you can just say simply create a playlist and name it Hello. And then you can put tracks in it, same as you can do with Serato. One of the additions that Engine DJ has these days is that you can take the entire folder and it will make subfolders playlists to that as well. You can see that here, CD1, here CD2. You can just drag and drop them in and then that will work. So yes, you can do that if you like to. However, I always recommend do it in iTunes because that keeps you flexible and use conversion tools to go back and forth. Let's see what else we got. Paul Hollyrod, hi Mixmaster G, Engine DJ, if you have two identical external hard drives and you're adding new tracks into a designated playlist folder, how do you ensure they stay ident if you are adding new or dragging from your collection? What I do is, first of all, I use my tools to create my Engine performance drives because that is tailored for that. And after that, I use a program named the Karman Copy Cloner. The Karman Copy Cloner is for Mac OS and it works very straightforward. Let's see if I have it on this computer. So let me find it for you. Karman Copy Cloner, where am I? There it is. And what you do is you basically just tell it what your source is and what your destination is. So if I look at my real life collection, this is my Master Engine Prime drive. If I hook it up, you can see it in a moment. There it is, Prime drive. That drive contains my... Really? Go away with it. Not now. Go away. I want to... Can I quit that? I should be able to quit it like this. All right. Let's see, and there we've got the Prime external backup. There you can see that right here you see the Prime drive, and right there you see Prime drive 1. And I can just click clone and it will make sure that they are in sync with each other, that they are identical. So that's what I recommend, but I also recommend it to create bootable backups from your startup drive to an external drive, stuff like that. Karman Copy Cloner is a lifesaver. It has a 30-day free trial period, but it's worth any penny. It has saved me so many times. So Karman Copy Cloner is your thing, and that will very quickly, just incrementally back up one drive to another. So I have one drive designated master and the other, it doesn't care. By the way, because how Engine DJ works, It is no longer important that both drives have identical names. They might have different names. They will keep working the same because the file paths in Engine DJ are relative. So it doesn't look at the drive. It just looks at a drive. It must be a drive, and the actual folder structure is much more important than the name of that particular drive. So you can take it that way if you like to. Tito Morales, good to see you. Mo Berry, good to see you too in the stream. So those are some questions that came in through the chat. And if you've got a question for me, just throw it in the chat and I'll be happy to let you know. Mo Berry asks, how is the conversion work with duplicate tracks and photos? I don't know what you mean by photos, Mo Berry. Do you mean artwork tags or do you mean photos? Because the photos are not being converted by DJ Conversion Utility. However, depending on the kind of conversion you run, for instance, if you use the Denon Conversion Utility, that will convert artwork from the tags of the audio file. So the tags of the audio file means the artwork is embedded in the audio file already as a tag. And the Denon Conversion Utility will take care to put that artwork inside Engine DJ. Same if you use the XML to Rekordbox 6 conversion, or actually the injector of an XML file into Rekordbox 6, that will take care of the artwork based on the artwork that is stored in the audio tags. Yeah, you mean artwork tags in the... So basically it depends on the conversion you are running. But to Rekordbox, if you use X26, which is part of the DJ Conversion Utility, and to Engine DJ, that is taken care of as long as the artwork is stored inside the audio files. Now, mind you that, for instance, WAV files don't have an official tagging scheme, which means there is no artwork embedded in the audio file, which means it is not converted. With the conversion from Serato or to Serato, the artwork is always taken by Serato from the audio file, so Serato takes care of that. The conversion to Traktor is a little bit more tricky, and that is because the way that Traktor deals with tags. I have a video about that, and there's an AMA about that if you're interested in that, but that is really a subject in itself. So going to Traktor, it might be tricky, but on average, it should work for most tracks. Then another thing we need to talk about, and that is duplicates, and especially duplicates within, I'm going to show it in iTunes, but this, the thing you are about to see will work, or will actually go wrong with most DJ software, if you use the relocate function. First of all, why am I going to show that in iTunes? Well, let me switch the screen again before I forget that. So here we are in iTunes, and I've got playlist one. You've got playlist one, and let me just make sure that everything is gone from here so there cannot be any issue. All right, we've got playlist one, and let's add the Jonas Brothers to that playlist. So there's one track in playlist one, right? So far, so good. Now, if I'm going to play that track, of course, it will play just fine. You can see that it's running there. I'm not putting the audio up because otherwise we get the famous copyright strikes from YouTube. So just it is running, and I did pause it right now. Now, one of the funny things of iTunes is that first of all, you cannot add a duplicate. The moment I try to add this track again to playlist one, then iTunes will tell me from, hey, are you sure? Because there is already a duplicate, so I can say skip, or I can cancel, or I can do whatever I want to. But hey, it will not edit. Even if I am in the playlist and I say edit, then on the song level, there will still only be one. You can see that, there's only one. So while there is a duplicate in the playlist, there's only one on the song level. Now, if we look on the information of that track, like this, then we can find the file, and you can see right here the entire file path to that track. Now, here comes the funny thing, and this is an iTunes exclusive, but this is also kind of intelligent relocate. If I change the name of that track to, I don't know, Jonas, usually your DJ software will stop playing it because it cannot find it unless you relocate it. However, iTunes is a little bit smarter than that. If I now look at the file, you will still see, or it already found it. You can see it automatically changes it without me doing anything. It finds it automatically. So let me do that again. If I say ASD Jonas, and I ask information about it, then you can see automatically that it is going up there. I need to have a look at this. Hold on for just a moment. All right, that's all good. So, in other words, iTunes is automatically changing the file path according to how I changed it. You don't need to relocate anything. Now, here comes the funny thing. If I add this track, of course it will be added and it will be a duplicate. Now, why is this added? The file path to that track is different. If we look right here, then, hold on, like this, we go to file. You can see that this one is actually on the desktop, while the other file was on the desktop in a folder, or this is actually on the desktop, not in a folder, and the other one is on the desktop in a nested folder. So those are different file paths. So as far as iTunes is concerned, those are different tracks. Now, here is the funny part. The moment I change, I did a little change in it, I can edit again. You can see, there it is, edit again. However, if I'm going through the file paths, then you can see that right here, this is the old one. This is the one with the eye with the little thing in front of it. And the last one is the one also with the eye in front of it. Because all of a sudden it realized, oh, damn, that track has changed. So now I have on my collection level, on my song level, two tracks which are pointing to exactly the same file path. However, those are treated as different tracks. Now, let me show you why this can become a problem. So let me make this a little bit easier. So we've got the track and we name it Jonas. Like this. I do that on purpose. And we add it to playlist number one. Like this. There it is. I make a new playlist. And playlist number two. Playlist number, playlist two, that's fine. And I've got playlist number one, which is empty right now. I can, of course, add the track to playlist number one, and if I do that, then it will be added. However, on the song level, on the collection level, there's only one track because it was the same track. Now, I remove it from here, and I'm going to rename it. I'm going to name it One Jonas One, and I'm going to add it to that playlist again. Now, all of a sudden, I've got two tracks because I changed the file path midstream. iTunes doesn't check for that. The same with a Rekordbox relocate, the same with the Serato relocate, the same with an Engine DJ, oh, it doesn't really have relocate, but the relocate function of your DJ software doesn't check if the track already exists either. So it will add duplicates the moment you are going to mess with the file paths. So now I've got one playlist where Who's in Your Head is in by the Jonas Brothers. And I've got another one. The tracks are identical because, hey, they are the same track. They are pointing to the same track. If I look at this here in the Finder then it will show it. Hold on. Do it like this, show in the Finder. And then I can give it a red dot. And if I go to this playlist and say show in the Finder, you will see that it will find that red dotted track. So it's the same track. Really, you see, there it is. It's that very same track. Now, if I remove one of them from the collection, they no longer are in both playlists. So if I say, all right, let's say, for instance, I'm deleting this from the library, like this. Now a playlist are incomplete because this playlist has it and this playlist doesn't have it anymore because I deleted one of them. So while they are on the same playlist or file path, while they are actually the same track, they are treated as separate tracks. The iTunes collection tool, that is my tool that helps you fighting duplicates using actually audio fingerprinting, will not find those duplicates because the file paths are identical. So if you want to get rid of those particular duplicates, I'm going to show you a little trick that might do it. I haven't tried this myself yet, but hey, we are going to give that a trick. So playlist one has it, playlist two doesn't have it. Let me just change the again and let me add it to playlist two. There we got it, playlist one, playlist two. We've got again two songs right here in the record box collection. Now let me fire up Quicksilver because I want to invoke one of the shortcuts that comes with the iTunes collection tool. And for that I need Quicksilver. There we are. And let's say we have those two. Now we have the opportunity with the iTunes collection tool comes a lot of scripts, a lot of little apps that I wrote and that you can invoke with keyboard shortcuts. That's why I needed Quicksilver that will start a script according on its keyboard shortcut. Now we can say, oh, ICT is not, why is ICT not, hold on folks, something going wrong. My ICT doesn't seem to be registered right here. So let me register it right away while we wait. We can do that right away. That's weird. I would have thought that it would be registered on the demo account, but hey, I can do that like this. So just bear with me for a moment. And most likely I need to, yeah, it's not registered indeed. Now it is. And you couldn't see it because hey, I'm not going to put my registration on screen for everybody to see. Now let me go to the system preferences and make sure that it is whitelisted because right now it is not, clearly it is not. Let's see, no, let me whitelist it. Sorry, this is the thing always in my streams. I always come up with stuff that I want to show you guys, but hey, then I forget that I need to whitelist my apps in order for this to be possible. This should be good now. Let me double check. Wafrin, I see your question. I get to it in a moment. Just bear with me if you want to. Okay, that has been done. So let me get back to my iTunes collection like this. Let me select them and let me invoke F9 because if I'm not mistaken, yes, that is the correct one. If you invoke F9 from Quicksilver using the iTunes collection tool, then it will ask you which of the two tracks in this case you deem to be the master, and that track will remain in the collection. The other one will be gone. However, the playlists that the other one is part of will be added to the track you remain in the collection. So you will not lose entries in the playlist. So that's the reason why I wanted to do this, because as you could see before, otherwise you have to run the risk that tracks are not there anymore. But right now you can see that both tracks are now maintained and I only have one track in my collection. So using the F9 key, if you use the iTunes collection tool, you can weed out, and it's a manual process, you can weed out those duplicates and then you can make sure that the one remains that you want to be there with all the playlist entries intact. And that last one is the most important thing. Let's see, Wafrin. Hey, Mixmaster G. Today I learned that track search and instant doubles on CDJs and XDAs skip hotkey autoload, which makes them dangerous or useless in my opinion. What do you think? Yeah, I saw that tweet you sent out to me, Wafrin. I didn't know that it was you that asked it. I don't use that function, to be honest. There is indeed this function that if you are on a CDJ, the CDJ will automatically skip to the first queue that it encounters when it loads the track. However, in certain circumstances, it will not auto-load or automatically jump to that queue. So then it doesn't work. And one of those instances, there was a hole. That's the auto queue. What is? You mean that it automatically loads the hot queue? I never experienced that, Wafferin, but I'm not the one who uses track search or search. I use instant doubles, and I think with instant doubles that I get my hot queues on my 3000s. But that might be a thing that indeed is happening if you use certain models of CDJs. Remember that the CDJ is a product range. It exists since the mid-90s, so it is already like 27 years old right now. All right, it's up to date for the CDJ 3000, Wafferin said. I believe you, my friend, but I don't use that. I just navigate through my playlists. And if I use instant doubles, I think my hot cues load. But if you want to be sure, then always have your memory cues too, because that should always work. And yes, I know memory cues are limited to what they can do compared to hot cues. That is why the DJ Converse Utility converts to both of them. All right. Yeah, I take your word for it, my friend. I take your word for it. So what you are saying is, if you use instant doubles, that the deck loading the double is not loading the hot cues. We can, of course, check that out. Why not? Let me fire up my CDJs. And in the past, that sometimes had a problem with me, with the audio cutting out. But hey, it looks like the audio is coming in just nicely. That CDJ is up. That CDJ is up too. Let me move the overhead cam so we have a clear look of what we are going to do. Let's see if I can get it entirely on screen, because it was set for the 6000s, but the 6000 doesn't want to let me go. Let's see. Here we are with CDJs. These are CDJ 3000s. They are on the latest firmware, not on any beta shit, because otherwise I could not show you this. Let me. That is what's happening if you are using. There we are again. Thank you, Sony. So those are CDJ 3000s. Now we need to prepare a CDJ USB, but we can do that very easily. Let's see if I am maximum zoomed out. So I hope that this is going to be visible, folks. And I can put my own face on it. There I am. Let me put myself there. I need to have the USB from the 6000 eject anyway. So Waden, you see, we spare no expense here at the ATDR production team. We try to help all you guys out as much as we can. Let me fire up my record box. And let's double check that indeed that is a FAT32. That is a FAT32, which is the safest of all formats. And we still got our track right there. So let me. Yeah, fine. Let me double check that indeed the track is on the USB. It is. Then we can safely eject it. And then we can switch to the overhead cam like this. Let me put it up. Let me load the source. And now you say if we use the search function, so we go to search, and this is the track name Don't Break My Heart. So we find the hit there. So let's load it up. And there my hot cue just loads just fine. So That is already not working because the hot cue is showing up just fine. The next thing we wanted to check out, make sure you have the hot cue auto load setting enabled in RecordBox. Yeah, it is enabled as you can see, and I can double check it in the utility folder on the DJ settings. Hot cue and auto load is on, as you can see. So that is loading, and that was through the search menu, my friend. Now I have to think, how do I first, let me do this, and then I have to think, how did I do a double, an instant double? I think it was by this one playing, and then that one double. Nope, that's not it. No, that's not it either. How did I load an instant double on a CDJ 3000? Let me double check that. Waveren, the odds are that the trick here is that this is a FET for, yeah, I tap load twice. I thought that too, but I'm looking which load I should use for that. Normally I use these things in tractor hit mode, as you might know. So these are basically my tractor controllers. But which is the load cue? Because if I do the encoder two times, I've got this one playing, and I want to have the, I am on that source, that is fine. There we are, right. That's not the one, and that's not the one either. Not loaded. That's not the one either too. I don't know what the instant double. No, that's not it. Yeah, I thought it was twice, but I think it's twice on Den and DJ. No, it's not holding it either. How can I load an instant double on CDJ 3000? All right, let me just do a quick Google here. Why not? Just to make sure. Instant double on CDJ 3000. Let's see what it tells us. Instant double CDJ 2000. Now instant doubles. Issue is this bug and you instant double on the instructions. Yeah, I agree. Oh, I need to set the master and then press the master. Press and hold the beat sync instant double button. All right. So this one is master indeed. Beat sync instant double. All right, so this one we have got playing. Press and hold the beat sync, and then indeed it loads up. And then it loads up with the hot cue enabled, my friend. So hey, even with instant doubles on the CDJ 3000s, that seems to work as well. So in short, this just works. At least it works on my CDJ 3000s with the latest firmware and with a CDJ USB that has been formatted FAT32. So that might be the trick. That format of the USB might be the trick. And maybe it is with the 2000 Nexus 2. I don't know. Hold on. Why not? Because I'm a nice guy and because we are playing with this anyway. Let me hide that screen. Hide message from the screen. That's it. Oh yeah, if you are always using FAT32, because I can imagine that there might be a discrepancy there, but as you can see, this is working just fine. This is working exactly as advertised by Pioneer Inc. So I think that's a good thing. But hey, if you want to see some more, I'm here, so just ask me. And by the way, if you might have any questions for me, just throw them in the chat. And I'm happy to address them. I think there was another question coming in as well. If not, then there's all Waffren there. And Waden, he was willing to cry after seeing Engine DJ. Ah, poor Waden. It isn't that bad anymore. It's consistent track search, doesn't load hot cues on the 2000 Nexus, but using browse plus load doesn't. It's consistent. Oh, all right, whatever you want, buddy. It's consistent track search, it doesn't load hot cues on the 2000 Nexus, but yeah, all right. Well, as you can see on the 3000, it is working, so maybe it's a bug that they fixed later on. there are a lot of things going on Pioneer DJ. And as I told you, CDJs are old technology and new technology alike. So you have chances that the old technology indeed had some bugs which are fixed in the latest versions. It totally makes sense. That is often the case, of course, with technology. So, hey, all we can do about it. Again, if you've got more questions for me, then throw them in the chat. For those of you who are late to the party, oh, no problem, Wafron. I'm here to help, so you never spam the chat. As long as it is on subject, then I'm totally cool with it. And if it is spam, then I'm very quickly in taking it down, because, hey, that's how we roll. Next week, May the 10th, I have my friend DJ TLM here, the last Mohemian straight from Amsterdam, but he will be right here in the ATTR production team studios. He will be playing with my toys. We will be talking DJ Tech together. We will be answering any and all of your questions. So please be with us in the live stream, because you can, of course, always watch these videos on demand from the YouTube channel. They are all the Ask Me Anything are right there. So they are there to help you out wherever they can. However, if I have a guest on, it's nice to have some people live in the chat that ask questions, just to make sure that we touch on all the subjects that interest you. Because, hey, I'm doing this stuff for you guys, to help you guys, because the answers most of the time I know myself, and otherwise I know where to find them. Tito Morales, thanks for the iTunes double explanation. Really needed that. Yeah, it is a little bit complicated. It is a little bit hard to wrap your head around, but it's also fixable. So yeah, you're welcome for that. And I can totally understand when people find that very complicated, but hey, it is doable. By the way, I just came up with that. We are not through yet, because there is one thing that I wanted to discuss with you guys. And that is, again, related to file paths. I was a guest in last week's Cleveland Terry show, and we were touching on the file path issue, because that was why I was over there. I wanted to explain something to Cleveland Terry, but I never explained it to you guys. And I wanted to show that to you guys. Because on the latest macOS version, and let me go to my Mac Mini for that, because I need to be on my Mac Mini in order to demonstrate this. Take that away, like this, and then there is my Mac Mini, and let me put that on the screen, like this. All right. I'm not going into details about file paths one again. I did that very often. However, what I always recommend is put your tracks on an external drive or a different volume or on a file server. So no matter what computer you are on, the file path to your audio files will always remain the same. Now, here is a trick that I learned recently, and it is a very important one. If you go to the disk utility on a recent macOS and your drive has been formatted APFS, and APFS, that is the default format that is these days used by Apple drives, then you've got the option to say partition. That is nothing new. Partition means you cut up your drive in parts. You partition the drive. In the past, when you partitioned a drive, you needed to know how big you wanted that partition to be, and that would take away storage space from the main drive. So you basically have a 100 gigabyte drive. You want to have a 25 gigabyte partition. That means the main drive will be 75 gigabyte and the other part will be 25 gigabyte, and that is fixed. So if you want to do this for a growing track collection, you need to make it very big already, because you want to add tracks to it. And that will take away space from the main drive. Now, what is new about the partitioning that Apple introduced, and I'm really enthusiastic about it, is this. You can, if you click the partition button and you click the plus to add the partition, you can say add a volume. Now, the difference between a volume and a partition is that it will still be a separate drive. It will still look like a separate drive. The file path will be to a separate drive, but the size will be dynamic. If there's nothing on it, it will not take any size from your main drive. And the moment you add tracks to it, it will slowly start to grow and take, of course, that growing space away from your main drive. And if you throw away tracks, then it will give back the size to the main drive. So you don't waste any storage space. And that is what makes this ideal if you use, for instance, a MacBook Pro. So I can add the volume. I'm doing this on a live computer. And just let's name that volume tracks. And there you can see that it's being formatted done. And there you can see there is a second drive there named tracks. And it works entirely as a new drive. It is an independent volume. And if you use that drive or that volume to store your audio files, then you will be so much more flexible if you move to a new computer or even a Windows computer, because all you need to do is backup that tracks drive and then you have everything. And no matter on what computer you are, if you are on a macOS computer, that drive will always be named tracks and the file path will always be pointing to that particular drive. So that gives you so much flexibility, and that is why I really, really, really wanted to see that, guys. But maybe in the future I will dive more into it, but I was so anxious about it. This is really a great find. Let's see, Moberry asks, how do you set up a USB mic in Streamlabs correctly and check? Moberry, I have no idea. I am an OBS user. Everything I do right here is in OBS. And on OBS, I've got my live, let me show that. Now we are going to look into Eternity, as you can see. But you can see that the microphone is right there. And I'm using my ATEM Mini Pro basically as the end mixer board. So I have the USB audio from the DGM 900 Nexus 2, which is the mixer that is right here. Let me, there. This mixer, that is a separate audio source from my microphones. I have two microphones, two wireless Sennheiser microphones, and both are routed through the ATEM Mini Pro into OBS, which gives you much more flexibility. So that's how I set up, and I have no idea how to do that in Streamlabs, so sorry, my friend. DJ Lumi, hello Mixmaster G. Why won't Rekordbox let me set the database to an external SSD formatted with macOS extended? Is there any way to do it? Actually, DJ Lumi, you need to know what you are talking about, because you can do that. You can make the Rekordbox database, or you can actually move the Rekordbox database to an external drive. Let me show that to you, because it is very easy to do that. Let me switch the screen. There we are again. And let me connect. That's my master drive. But that's already mounted. Let me add or disconnect a Prutz drive. Now, remember, Lumi, there are two things. We have a CDJ prepared USB, and that means a CDJ prepared USB from Rekordbox. Or we have what is known as a Rekordbox collection drive. And that those are two different things. The collection is your entire Rekordbox collection, and the CDJ USB is just a USB you prepare from that big Rekordbox collection. You can connect to a CDJ. Incompatible disk, not interesting. So let me format that Prutz drive. There we are. And let me format it, erase, guide, macOS extended, and let's call it Prutz. Now, what most likely is going wrong, DJ Lumi, is something that is plaguing all DJ apps these days, and that is that in order for an app to take advantage of an external drive, it must be added to the security and privacy settings. Go to your system preferences, right under the Apple. Go to security and privacy, and this might look a little bit different depending on the OS you are on. I am on a Mojave machine, but it is there on everything. And then go to the privacy tab, unlock it, go to the full disk access pane, and make sure that Rekordbox is inside that pane, as well as any other software that wants to access that external drive. If it is not there, then Rekordbox might want to use it, but the OS will prevent it to use it. So that is most likely what is wrong. But if it is there, as you can see, it is there for my collection, then I can go to Rekordbox. And you have seen that I made a Rekordbox macOS extended. I go to the preferences and let's see, it is, I think, under view or something. Always have to find where they hide that. There it is. And then I can say, I want to go to volume storage. Oh, I see now what you mean. Indeed, it doesn't go to an extent. Never noticed that. You're right. You are absolutely right. It doesn't go to a macOS extended. That's interesting. Let me double check what happens if I make it an exFAT. I never noticed that, my friend, but hey, it seems to be indeed the case. I want to make double sure that that wasn't the case on Rekordbox 5 as well. Because I'm not that much a mover of my Rekordbox database, but I know, for instance, that I can use the Rekordbox database on my file server, which is an HFS device. No, I don't need to update, do not sync. No. Okay. This is a very big collection, as you can see, but hey, let's see what happens if I tell it. No, it doesn't show it either. So as soon as the drive is ejectable, then it doesn't want to, it. As a precaution, I can see why they want to do that, actually. I can see, because the moment you fire up Rekordbox and that drive is not mounted to your desktop, then Rekordbox doesn't know what to do. But it would be more... no problem, Falcon G. Always welcome. Always welcome to the chat. So I can see why they want to do that. But hey, it really doesn't make much sense. So let's try a different format. Why not? So I'm here anyway. Let's erase it and let's make it... first, let's go for a FAT. Because FAT should always work. And then it's still a removable. So in theory, it shouldn't also not, it should not work as well. Because, hey, you don't want to do that. Let's see. And then we fire up Rekordbox again. Never noticed this one. So that's fun. No, it doesn't allow me to move the data. So in short, it looks like it's not the macOS extended that is messing with it. I think the fact that it is a removable drive. In FAT it works. No, it doesn't. This drive is now FAT32, as you can see. And if I go to Rekordbox, let me just double check, and I can make it an MBR FAT. But as far as I could see, I didn't get the option. Preferences. No, it's not there. I cannot select it. I only can select the storage drive. And the storage drive is actually a drive that is there, which is basically a hard drive. That's this one. That's an internal drive. But let's get creative. Why not? First of all, let's try it as an MBR FAT, because right now it's a guide FAT. So let's just make double sure that it's indeed an MBR FAT. Erase it. Let's go to the MBR, and then untitled is fine, and I want it to be FAT. Maybe then it loses its removable tag or property, but I don't think so. It shouldn't lose that property at all, but let's see what we can do. Yes, there it is, but I don't want that. I want to bag it up, so I want to move it. No, still not there, buddy. But we are going to have some fun, because right now I make it an extended erase master extended. Yeah, journal. It's fine. By the way, never use case sensitive, folks. I still sometimes get people with Mac sensitive, but don't do that. Just stay Mac OS extended. And let's go back to guide. Maybe it puts like this. Did it only, but the speed of the SSD is higher in macOS extended than FAT. That's correct. To move video mapping format from Rekordbox, that's why I was asking. Yeah, but are we talking about the same thing, Lumi? Are we talking about moving your database, moving the collection, or are we talking about creating a CDJ USB, preparing a USB? Because those are two entirely different beasts. So that I need to know. But hey, since I'm here, I'm going to try something else. I'm going to try the following. Namely, I'm going to move my database to my storage drive, and then I'm going to clone that to Prutz. XFAT works. I have one SD in this format. As long as it's an removable, it will not work. Trust me. But I'm going to try something else here. I'm going to get a little bit creative here. We are going to volume storage. Yes. There's already something there, obviously. I hope not. All right, now we are on volume storage and there is something there. Oh, I can see there's a test database there. Okay. Now this is a hidden thing, but hey, for those of you who were interested in why Carbon Copy Cloner is such a great tool, I'm going to show you. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the database, quit record box, come on, you can do that. What is it doing? There, that's better. I'm going to take a Carbon Copy Cloner. And I'm only going to, and let's make a new one. And I want to go from this to there. However, that won't fit. So safety net, we switch that off. Some files, I turn everything, go away. I turn everything off and I only want the Pioneer folder, which is a hidden folder. You cannot see that Pioneer folder. That is the little dot in front of the name that makes it hidden. And that is the reason why I do it like this. So done, and let's clone it over. Yeah, run now. And if you go to Prutz, we cannot see anything happening. You can see that it's eating some space there. And you can see that right here, it is copying stuff, but you cannot actually see what it's doing because it's hidden. But it's done now. And let's see if Recordbox now can switch to that particular database, because that is what I'm curious about. No, not sync. Okay, go away. Let's go to the preferences. Yep, then it finds it. So there is a way, DJ Lumi, to make this possible. As you can see, it is not simple, but you need an internal drive to do it first. And then you can go from that internal drive to the external and then it will work. So it is a workaround. It is a little bit of a shortcut you take. But hey, you can do it if you want to. But I'm still not sure if we are talking about the same thing. I'm still not sure if you are talking about a CDJ prepared USB from a Recordbox collection, or if you want to move your entire Recordbox collection, which are two entirely different beasts. But hey, both is possible, as you can see. But you need to get a little bit more creative than that. And let's see if it keeps that. Let's make a little test. So let's go back to my Prutz drive, like that. And then let's just add some tracks and do some stuff and then see what's happening. Just out of curiosity. And I never tried this before, so create new playlist. This is new. And then let's add some tracks to it. Okay, and let's quit it. Now let me eject the Prutz drive. Yeah, I know, but it will be done in a moment. To clean up the mess a little bit there. Now I can eject it. Now let's fire up Recordbox and it should start to complain. You see, it cannot find the master database. Do you want to open master in the default drive? No, I don't. Now let me add the drive again. So what is not possible? I'm still thinking why that is the case. There should be an easier way to do this. let me remove that Pioneer folder from my storage folder. So let me double check some other stuff. Do not sync. Okay, okay, and there it is again. There, this is new, and that is all on the external drive. So hey, that all works. Now I have a little utility. There is, by the way, there is a way to. There was a shortcut for this. No, that's not a shortcut. Shift M or. There was a shortcut to show hidden files. I don't want to go to trash. I want to go here. To show hidden files in on a drive, but I forgot what that shortcut was. However, I have a little app for that. And that app is named Show All Files. Show. And let me take away database from the storage drive. Where is it? Pioneer.pioneer.pioneer. I don't see it at all. Ah, there it is. .pioneer. Let me trash that. Let me let me make it visible first. Oh, I could have made like this. Now you can see it. And let me hide all the files. So where are my show files? There. Hide. Right, now it's there, I can move it away. Let's see if I just can go from Racketbox to that drive again. So I did empty the database from the storage drive. Oh, no, 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 no. You see, there should be an option to move the database, because that was not what I was looking for, actually. Because now it doesn't show my storage drive, and there should be a way to show that. Library sync, no, 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 no. No idea where that is hidden. Not there, not there, not there. And there used to be a way to move that, but hey, I might be entirely wrong with this one. So I want to make double sure that indeed, not there, not there, advanced, no, only there, database management. But in a single external drive as well as tracks, you can manage your collection easily among multiple computers. If you change the computer or USB port, the external drive is connected, please make sure. Yeah, but how can I move that? Because right now I cannot move it to storage, as you can see. I did move it to my other drive, but let's see if there is a backup export collection view. I think you can do it with the backup function. A library. Backup library, like this. Yeah, that's fine. No, export music files. No, 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 like that. I don't know where the collection move option has gone in Racketbox. So sorry, folks. I might be wrong with that. Let's see. What do we have? Wireless Karma. Hey, there's some issue with my collection in the database. That doesn't tell me much, buddy. There is an issue with the collection in the database. What database, what collection, and what issue do you have? So, need more info, otherwise I cannot help you. Dear Lumi, it is for 4K video to mapping video entire collection. From Racketbox SSD speed is high. Yeah, yeah, I know, I know, I know. I know Mac OS Extended is much faster than FAT. That is correct. That is entirely correct. I'm wondering what you want to do. Do you want to prepare a CDJ USB, or is it just for storage? Because if it's just for storage, then why not put your 4K files on an external and put your database where it belongs on your home folder? Because that will be just as fast as well. There is no need to separate those. But I can understand that you want to put your video files on an external. And I always recommend put your media in general. If they are audio files, video files, I don't care. Put them on a separate volume. As I just earlier showed you, you can make a volume with partitioning now that will automatically grow and shrink with the size of the collection. And I always recommend you to do that. But in general, I don't recommend messing with the location of the database, because that will just give you much, much problems in the future. Wireless Karma, if you need help, then I need more information. Otherwise, I cannot help you, my friend. DJ Lumi, I hope this one is clear now, because I'm still not entirely clear what you're trying to do. So as long as that's not clear, then yes, I know macOS Extended is faster than FAT. That is correct in general. But you especially see it when you are going to sync using the Rekordbox sync manager from the collection to a USB device. So that is where those things come in. My friends, if there are any more questions, then please drop them in the chat. Then this is the time to do that, because otherwise we are running for almost 1.5 hours right now, which means that usually that is the time that I'm signing off, but only if I did answer all the questions that are out there. Don't forget, next week, May the 10th, I have my friend DJ TLM right with me here in the ATGR Production Team Studios. And we will talk all DJ all evening, answering your questions, playing with toys. So if you got questions for us, just ask them and be there with the stream, so we have an audience and we can answer those questions. We for sure will be busy, because TLM has some questions for me as well about his collection, and I will answer them in the stream. But in general, if you've got questions, just throw them in the chat and be there live. I hope to see you all next week. Thank you for hanging out with me today. It has been a little bit of a long stream, but I was expecting this already. If you like what I'm doing, then don't forget to put those thumbs ups in the chat like this. And if you have questions, you can leave them in the comments right below. For now, thank you all for watching. Mixmaster G signing off.